us your presentation. Thanks.
Many thanks, Diego. I will also try to share my screen. Please let me know if you can see my PowerPoint now.
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, thank you. And thank you also, Dr. Misha Vallad, if I pronounce it well, for your presentation, which in many ways relates to my proposal here, to how Ashura is performed in Greece. So many things converge from the situation in Greece with the situation in Italy. But first of all, I have to apologize in the sense that I'm not a Shia scholar, not a religious studies scholar. I'm a performance studies scholar, and I'm interested in ritual and theatrical performances by displaced people, mainly by refugees, asylum seekers and migrants in Greece, and ritual and theatrical performances which relate to lament, to the practice of lamentation. So this is how I came to the Shiite performance of lament, and mainly to the Ashura, during my doctoral research since 2014. And then this argument that we present today, how performing Ashura in Piraeus can lead us to think towards the Shiite poetics of cultural intimacy, as I will define it in what follows, was also the main subject of my first postdoctoral research at the Greek Center, Greek Research Center for the Humanities. So at the start of my research on the Ashura 7 years ago, I focused on the Pakistan Shia Muslim Association. I will call it through its abbreviation from now on, PSMA. First of all, because it's the longest established Shia Muslim association in Greece, and the one that has attracted most public attention, primarily due to the Ashura. Its history dates back to 1978, when the religious practices of a then small community took place privately in people's homes. PSMA is based at the Azahana Guzare Zainab, the Garden of Zaina, which is this abandoned warehouse. You can see the door here, which is situated in Piraeus, Greece's major port. Although very close to the town center, this is a non-residential, a post-industrial area, and the landscape again is dominated by abandoned small factories and warehouses. So since 2004, the predominantly male community, Pakistani community in Greece, commemorates Muharram mostly within its premises, this abandoned warehouse, which is arranged as a prayer hall. Let me also tell you that Greece, last year, was the only Greek capital without an official mosque, the only European capital, sorry, without an official mosque. And the 10 days observed on the street outside the prayer hall, with the procession reaching its climax in self-flagellation. Both national and international media are widely invited to capture and transmit the event. And yet the organizers frame the ritual, as you can see here, with two voluminous pieces of cloth based on both sides of the street. So combining semi-structured interviews and participant observation with archival research, in what follows, I will try to show how at the contextualized focus on self-flagellation and to the act of bloodshedding in particular, accentuated by the mass media, reinforces local stereotypes of Shia community practices as incompatible with Greek or European cultural values. Moreover, I will demonstrate that confronted with xenophobia and social estrangement, my Shiite interlocutors systematically attempt to articulate counter-narratives of cultural intimacy that stress the similarities of their lament with Greek embodied practices of religiosity. And finally, I will juxtapose dominant narratives related to the Greek national self with the discourses and practices of the migrant Shiite community of Piraeus, focusing on the symbolic and practical uses of blood. So in order to better understand current debates on the Ashura in this contemporary migratory context, I shall bear in mind that the performative aspects of the Muharram rituals, and especially the publicly exposed self-flagellation, have often been considered diametrically opposed to the theological foundations of Islam. Various critiques are not articulated only by Sunni Muslims or non-Muslims, but also by a Shiite, by a number of Shiite religious scholars. To mention two indicative examples, during the 30s, when Lebanon was in the process of gaining independence from France, I quote, modernists opposed themselves to what they perceived as barbaric or uncivilized practices. So there is an interruption from somebody with the mic switch on. A major figure in this critique was the leading Shiite cleric Mushin Alamin, who was particularly concerned with honing a modern, self-controlled and reasoned image of Shia believers, exhibiting, I quote, a particularly modernist anxiety about the sanctity of the individual body. Alamin argued that any self-harming activity was religiously unacceptable and that, I quote, the most important thing is the protection of the self. From a different standpoint, during Muharram in 1995, Iran's political and religious leader Ayatollah Khamenei outlawed the public performance of self-flagellation. In his words, I quote, it is not a question of individual or physical harm, but of great injuries to the reputation of Islam. As quoted by Pinault, not the ritual act per se, but the image of the Shiites to the rest of the world, an even more urgent issue within contemporary contexts of globalized Islam, to use Olivier Roy's expression. At the same time, I shall also note that the practices, as you know better than me, of blood shedding today are often replaced by or coexist with blood donation campaigns, both in the Muslim world and in the West, but as I will show you what follows, not yet in Greece. Studies from other European migratory contexts also demonstrate different crucial issues at work throughout the Muharram rituals, such as tradition, memory, belonging, and community, but also transformation. Yet by concentrating on Northern European countries, this body of literature demonstrates mainly how the Shiite lament is performed and experienced in multicultural and to borrow Dr. Michel Vallat's expression, former colonizing countries and societies whose traditions and habits are perceived as directly opposed to the Shia embodied expressions of mourning. Acts of excessive mourning, including self-harm, are characterized as, to borrow one of Catherine Spellman Pooch's informers, so un-British. Things are quite different in Greece, where many of my interlocutors compare their own lamenting practices with Greek embodied practices of religiosity. Borrowing and redefining here Michael Hertzfeld's expression in a contemporary context of heterogeneity, I argue that in this sense, Shiites in Greece do not rely on multicultural difference, but foreground a poetics of cultural intimacy. For instance, some of my informers underline the element of religious self-harm in rituals such as the Christian Orthodox pilgrimage to the Church of the Virgin Mary on the island of Tinos, which you can see in this photo. During the major celebrations of that church on August 15th, many pilgrims fulfill their vows by walking on their knees all the way from the port to the Virgin Miraculous icon. Moreover, many of them compare the Ashura with Holy Friday and the Lament of Hussein with the Lament of Christ, pointing to the procession of the dead Jesus Epitaphios. And this is the coffin for Jesus Christ in the Orthodox, Eastern Orthodox tradition, the Epitaphios. So this is the preclimatic moment in the performative drama of Holy Week, but also the term for the gold embroidered icon carried on the pole, the piece of cloth bearing a representation of Christ's crucified body. So my discussions highlight the striking similarities between the ways of expressing faith in both religions, the Holy Friday and the Ashura, but also between the two sacred objects, the Epitaphios and the Tabut, right, the coffin for Imam Hussein. Finally, several interlocutors also refer to the Anastenaria, a ritual involving fire walking that takes place in northern Greece by locally descending from Eastern Thracian refugees, remarking that fire walking is a common practice during the Ashura commemorations in Pakistan and throughout South Asia, where it is shared even among other religions such as Hinduism. Although they emphatically underline the similarities, My interlocutors at the same time assert that they would not allow themselves to perform firewalking in Greece, as they say would not feel comfortable to do in a foreign country what we would do in our own. And we can discuss about it then. So it is important to raise here a question. If in the previous cases, the Ashura is linked with major and official Greek Orthodox rituals, what happens when comparisons are drawn with the ritual of Anastenaria? Although the Anastenaria practitioners, descendants of refugees, consider themselves to be Christians, the ritual is not fully recognized by the official Greek Orthodox Church. Furthermore, and despite the attempt of Greek folk studies to inscribe this ritual in the discourses of continuity by the revival of Dionysian cults, the Anastenaria is today generally considered a marginal practice in Greek society. What happens then when the Shiites compare their lament not with a nation's canon, but with its margins? Do they in this case not simply articulate the poetics of cultural intimacy, but rather in a much more complex way unsettle the operational binary between intimacy and difference? Do they simply suggest not that we are like you, but that you are not like yourselves, that is, the ones you would like to believe you are? In any case, their arguments are interesting exactly because they relativize the exotic character of their own lament, linking it with local practices of religiosity. This argument is further supported by other receptions of the Ashura in Greece, such as the movie I Heard God Crying by cinematographer Elpida Skoufalou. In this, the Shiite lament for Hussein is interwoven with the lament of the Anastenaria devotees for the hero Mitro Konstantinos and of South Albanian women for a real dead person. The shooting and editing of these images appears not to juxtapose exotic laments to indigenous ones, but on the contrary, to trace the common features of different rituals of lament. So this is clearly not the case of the televisual representations of the Ashura, despite the fact that during the last decade, there has been a significant change in perspective, at least as far as influential national mainstream media are concerned. Looking into the news coverage of the ritual by the private TV channel Antenna since 2013, we can observe a shift towards an increasingly moderate, tolerant gaze on the other. The ritual is no longer exposed solely as a proof of the irrational, exotic difference, but rather explained and contextualized. Details are given on Shi'ism in general and on the Kerbala battle as its founding narrative in particular, while the camera does not emphasize on self-flagellation, but also takes into consideration the less spectacular aspects of the ritual, and the voiceover explains that for Shias, the self-flagellation is a way to verify their faith and to be redeemed. Moreover, a clear demarcation line is traced between Islamic terrorism and Shiite minorities, explaining that the latter constitute a repeatedly oppressed population in the Muslim world and currently a primary victim of organizations such as the Islamic State or the Taliban, especially in the TV programs during 2014-2015. So such a distinction echoes the systematic attempts of my interlocutors who have tried to clarify for years their position as a vulnerable religious minority. As they repeatedly explain, we are the easiest targets for the jihadists. Yet, looking back to past programs on the same channel, the adjectives used to describe the ritual had more negative connotations: impressive, unusual, shocking, or even extremely ferocious. These are the words used by the TV channel. The more we go back in time, the more clangorous the vocabulary tends to be. In earlier years, the Shiites mercilessly, in delirium, submitted themselves to hideous tortures, I quote, and injured themselves with knives until they fainted. Even though, as mentioned already, the Ashura is commemorated at a non-residential area, it is interesting to note how in these journalistic narratives, the ritual appears to take place, I quote, at the very center of Piraeus, while the inhabitants of Dimitra Streets, and as I said, they are non-inhabitants of Dimitra Street, watch breathlessly what takes place in front of their houses. The very first coverage of the Ashura by Antenna Channel in 2004, only a few years after 9/11, and just before the 2004 Olympic Games in Athens, is characteristic. The broadcaster attests that the extreme manifestation of religious devotion by Shia Muslims residing in Greece preoccupies the authorities. as they estimate that within this organization, it is possible for Al-Qaeda members to intrude. I quote, shots of training Al-Qaeda soldiers are rapidly interwoven with images from the interior of the Azahana marked by a red target. And although the broadcaster adds that the Shia claim to be enemies of the Taliban, the narrative produced by this editing is clear. The practices of terrorism are connected to the extreme manifestation, I quote, of religious devotion. Violence against others is connected of violence against the self. Yeah. So in the last decade, such a perception of the Ashura has been reproduced by the far-right press in Greece. In the vocabulary of the neo-Nazi party Golden Dawn, whose members were sentenced and imprisoned in September 2020, the open wounds of the Shiites contaminate, I quote, the bleeding streets of the homeland. While their self-directed violence is read as the threat of a future armed invasion. And once again, the Ashura is portrayed as taking place in downtown Piraeus, which loses its identity as the main Greek port and, I quote, becomes Islamabad. The bloodshedding of the Shias becomes a threat to the national body and its purity of blood. I would like to briefly refer here to the symbolic and practical uses of blood. In May 2013, amidst extreme neo-Nazi violence in the public space, the PSMA received an anonymous letter in Greek, in English and Arabic, addressing its receivers as Muslim murderers, insulting Islamic religion, and concluding with a threat, I quote the original translation, there will be blood. So directly inspired by German Nazis and its roots in the Blutundboden, blood and soil ideology, Greek neo-Nazis not only cast the blood of these national, racial, and religious others as polluting, but also clearly state their will to spill it by their own initiative. It is worth noting here that Golden Dawn was not only the party that has orchestrated or supported murderous attacks against Evian subjects throughout the country, including a Pakistani migrant, but it has also run blood donation campaigns for native Greeks only. So returning to the Shiite themselves, it is crucial to repeat that blood donation has been an increasingly frequent practice that replaces or coexists with bloodshedding during the Ashura commemorations, both in the Muslim world and in the Western migratory context, but not yet in Greece. The Shiite spokesman, Ashir Haider, expressed to me his intention to initiate such a campaign in Greece on behalf of the PSMA, an intention that did not materialize, because according to the responsible person he discussed this issue with, I quote, people from South Asian countries, including Pakistan, are not allowed to donate blood because of fear of transmission of certain diseases. And indeed, the regulations of the Ministry of Health clearly state that men and women, and I quote, that had sexual contact with individuals that live or come from Africa, sub-Saharan countries, South Asia, South America, and the Pacific Islands in the course of the last decade, are not allowed to give blood. I would like to suggest that in this case, the biopolitics of the state obliquely echo Nazi ideas regarding blood, as they do not allow this foreign blood to be offered by a group of religious others to the national body. In Roberto Esposito's terms, the communitas of the nation state is essentially based on its immunitas. Borders become a corporeal metaphor, while flowing in the streets of the city, the blood of others is perceived as a threat, an intruder, an infection. And even if on the level of discourses and representations, the distance between us and others can be crossed through a poetics of cultural intimacy, when we move towards national health regulation, we are also once again confronted with the politics of difference and in this case of exclusion. We have 3 minutes for the conclusion?
Yeah, definitely.
Thank you. So to conclude, I would like to remark that in this migratory context, and fully conscious of the neo-orientalist image produced by the media, the Shia community in Greece foregrounds the politics of visibility and the poetics of cultural intimacy, which aims to undo stereotypical associations of the Shia faith with the act of bloodshedding. Connecting the productive use of the blood in Greek hospitals with its ritual expenditure in the state of Piraeus, the useful work of blood donation counterpoints the spectacle of blood shedding and the open wounds, foregrounding the universal message of Shi'ism over embodied practices of faith. Nonetheless, the foreign blood of the Shias cannot flow into the national body. Wasted in the streets of the city, it becomes the ultimate proof of their supposed clash with post-enlightenment European values. Yet I would like to suggest that depicting the other mirrors, even if obliquely in this case, the self. It seems to me that this insistence on casting the laments of others as barbaric, oriental, and consequently pre-modern, reveals an anxiety regarding Greece's own Western and European identity, an identity that seems not to be fully guaranteed. In other words, we try to secure our civilized or European status by casting the others as barbarians. Or in poet Konstantinos Kavafis' terms, we need barbarians as our own solution, which guarantees our own inscription to the Western world of privilege, together with an obsessive repulsion of our inner East. Thank you very much. I had the last short video, but I don't know if I have the time to show different perspective, but you let me know. There is no...
Okay, we are at 21 minutes, so if it's not very long, we can check it out.
Yeah, I can just show you 1 minute because it's a video by, it's a slideshow by the photographer Tassos Bretos, and it's a different perspective from an artistic point of view, which does not collides with the media perspective, but is a trigger for the discussion. If you want, we can discuss at the end, but just I show you a little bit. Thank you very much, and we can also discuss about how art reproduces each image, and how it collides or it diverges from the media discourses about this event.
All right, thanks, Dr. Chatziprokopiou. Thanks very much for this very informative and thoughtful analysis of rituals and their broader cultural and social and somewhat also political implications. Very powerful pictures. We end up with this, series of pictures that's quite evocative in many ways. Okay, so that's another very, very interesting presentation.